This is part two of my conversation with a Seventh-day Adventist about Jehovah's Witnesses. Sorry about the road noise. We were driving on a dirt road, so there's going to be a lot of bumping noise and stuff in the background. Right now you're hearing a generator in the background, so sorry about that. But here's part two.
Well, you know, my brother calls it mythology, which irks me to no end. You know,
when I talk Bible stuff, I it's kind of like practice for me. So when I do apologetics, talking to my wife.
Oh.
But when I talk to my wife, the kids are in the same room, and they listen to everything, even though they may seem not paying attention. So my intended audience is actually my kids, even though I'm talking to my wife.
Yeah, that's...
So...
Well, you know, there is some encouragement for you. Studies done by our church on belief systems and by other churches too, but our church has got what they call a Genesis study, and the belief systems of the father actually, while the mother has big influence, the belief system of the father actually has more effect on the children's spiritual life than the mother's does.
Really?
Yeah. That's at least that's the studies that they found in among our denomination. So if the father's an agnostic, the kids will have a better than average chance of being agnostics.
Gotcha.
Whereas if the father is very strong in the church, and a loving father, not an abusive, but a loving father, you know, a good father, not a...
I try to be. That's why I'm fighting so hard to keep him out of being a...
What I mean is not abusive.
Yeah, yeah.
Something that, you know, not a feared father, but a loved father. The kids will have a much better percentage or chance of being strong in the faith.
Gotcha.
So if that's any encouragement, you know.
Yeah, definitely. It's funny. I started off as an agnostic two years ago and before, and you know, the JWs, they have these conventions and you know, the meetings and stuff, and it's a brainwashing. It's an exercise of brainwashing, and they drill really a lot that, okay, if you have an unbelieving father or one of the parents is an unbeliever, you know, don't listen to him because he's not following the Bible, their Bible, and he's in the power of Satan. So. And you know,
do they vote?
They don't. They totally go with not being part of this world, being totally.
I'm sorry, but if you don't vote, it doesn't say you have to be a politician. But,
no.
But you're also supposed to. You're supposed to realize that that God sets up, even if you don't like it, God allows. They say sets up, but in reality, He allows. Certain governments, he allowed the Roman government, even though it was killing Christians.
Yep. Every municipal, what is it, powers in the world and everything is blessed by God or whatever.
Or allowed by God because, and there's reasons.
That and, you know, give what belongs to Caesar, is Caesar's, and give what, you know, yeah, totally. And they do use those verses and stuff, but
they don't vote.
They don't vote, no.
How can you, I guess if you're not of this world, you really don't care, but then why do you want to save the other people?
Because they're working for salvation.
Their own salvation or the other people's?
They want to save other people's, but it's really their own, subconsciously.
See, that's the Seventh Adventist Church. It's basically the reason to be a missionary is because you do not want people to be lost.
Right. Right. Well, they would say that too, but kind of like a subroutine in their indoctrination, you also are commanded to go preach door to door and all that. That's why you see him, you know, knock on doors all the time.
You're commanded as a Christian to spread the word. I mean, that's, you're not to hide us. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden.
Right. But if you're saved and you know you're saved and you got that assurance that you are going to be saved, you would want to do that anyway, you know? It's your choice.
Be there.
Right. But they're not sure that they're saved until after the 1,000 years. And so, it's a work-based salvation.
Well, see, that's the problem. And that's the problem with every religion that... And that's when the religions become authoritarianism. They're works-based.
Yep. Yep.
I mean, you look at the Buddhists, you look at Confucianists, you look at Taoists, you look at bring it closer to home. You look at the Muslim religion, and some of the Christian denominations too. Yep. But you see, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they don't call themselves Christians, do they?
They say they do, but in practice, they don't. You know,
because Christians means you accept Christ as the Savior and as God. That's what a Christian is.
Right, but they redefine words.
Okay.
They totally redefine words. What's a word that they redefined? I forget. They got a bunch of them. Like I said, they use Christian buzzwords and definitions so they could... having something similar with other Christians.
That's a pizza box.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. It is interesting that a number of Catholics do not call themselves Christians.
Wow.
They're Catholic.
Gotcha. Same with them. Same with them in a way, but they do stress that yes, they are Christians, even though all these other things that kind of would be by definition not Christian and not Christian like they adhere to, like, you know, all this other stuff.
Yeah.
But
when I lived in Costa Rica, a lot of them did not refer themselves as Christians.
The Catholics you were talking about?
Yeah, the Catholics.
Oh, wow.
I'm Catholic. But are you Christian? I'm Catholic. So they don't really understand. I think it's a problem they don't understand what a Christian is, because by definition they believe in Christ the Savior.
Right.
And the
basic tenet of the gospel itself.
And the deity, and they believe in his holiness and his deityness by the fact that they've elevated to Mary, and I didn't understand this, but the Catholic Church does in a way elevate Mary to almost a deistic status by virtue of the fact that she... I had a Catholic explain to me, he said, yes, she was also immaculately conceived. Well, why? Because nothing human was capable of carrying the Christ child.
I would say, what verse is that in the Bible?
It's not.
Exactly.
But that's of course, the...
Yeah.
It may be, though, in the Apocrypha. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, I don't know much about it. But
I just know that there's the... I have read some lines in the Apocrypha, and I shake my head and say, this kind of goes against back here.
Yeah.
And that's why the canon that was developed over the years of the sacred books is because those all agree, whereas the Apocrypha don't seem to agree with the rest of it.
Right, yep. It's just like the JWs, but with the Watchtowers. To them, they won't tell you this. There's a lot of stuff that they won't tell you that they believe, unless you're a member. Like, all the Watchtower magazines is an extension of the canon of the 66 books.
Yeah.
And it's, well, yeah.
So I thought the Watchtower was just a Bible study. So it's not really.
It is.
Proof texts or something?
The proof texts, yeah. They're heavy on proof texts and cherry picking scriptures. It's like the Bible. Conventionally, the Bible dictates theology. To them, theology dictates the Bible. So they have this the worst translation, you know, that they have that you know, like Jesus made all other things or created all other things, and the a God thing, and there's a slew of other mistranslation in the Bible as well. But it's they use their Bible study to recruit people.
Yeah, well, I have looked at the Watchtower and I see, oh, it's got this text that says, okay.
Yeah.
But I don't read it because I know it, as soon as I know that they don't accept Christ as full-blown son of God. They say, yes, he's the son of God, but you don't understand. Son, yeah, I can say,
co-eternal.
Son to somebody who's my equal.
Yeah.
My same age. Listen, son, in some ways, if you're mentoring somebody, he's your son.
Yeah.
And Christ, when he was born, yeah, he was God's son because he had to relearn everything that he built this earth, but he had to learn about it then because he was human.
He grew up amongst them.
He grew up amongst them, and he didn't get born with this innate I'm God, because then it would have defeated the purpose of him coming, which was to show that he could, by fully relying on the Father. The whole reason for Christ to come was to show that Satan's charge that you could not be perfect, you could not be a holy person. His purpose for coming was to show that, yes, it is possible to live a holy life by relying fully on God. And that's what Christ's whole purpose was to rely fully on God the Father.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that book study thing, like I was saying, it's to learn their theology by the misinterpretation of the Bible itself, to kind of prove that they are the only chosen people and all that.
It's 144,000.
Yep.
That's a different interpretation of the
144,000. Oh, yeah.
The 144,000 to the Adventist Church is, it's a select group of maybe those who have gone through the worst persecution and still remain faithful, you know. Like you and I haven't been through any persecution like the believers in China are going through today.
No.
And they get thrown in jail and beat, raped, you know, tortured, everything else.
Gotcha.
And yet they remain faithful.
So those passages in Revelation, do you believe that all those sort of like description of the 144,000 is all symbolic?
No, I...
Or all...
You know, I don't have a firm... I have a kind of an overall...
Sure,
like,
me too.
On them. I don't have a firm what exactly are, but I do believe that they are people who are special, but there's people because they have been tried worse than I have.
Right.
You know, I don't believe that I would be part of the 144,000 because, you know...
We live a troubled life, considering.
We live in the United States.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it's so far, it's freedom of religion.
Now, how about during the first century where they were throwing them to the lions and stuff and were using them as torches, so...
Yeah. I mean, Diocletian, yeah, lined the road with them and set them on fire.
See, that's a kind of little stumbling thing that I kind of tease my wife about. Try to put some common sense into her and say, so you come to tell me that only Jehovah's Witnesses are part of the 144,000. How about all the... proven, you know, documented in history from the first century until present time, there totally has been tenfold more martyrs, you know, dying for the faith. You know, like the gladiators, the Spanish Inquisition, and who knows, you know, every other scenario. Don't you think that the ranks have been filled, you know, in the first century, and you still have people living today that claim to be part of the 144,000? I was like, well, no, because there weren't true Christians back then. That's the claim that they'll make. That is the party line that they use. You know, and it's like,
I don't know, I'd find it very hard to judge somebody that put their life on the line.
Oh, I know, especially Jehovah's Witness, who don't, you know, who don't take part in the world anyway. But get this, according to the history, if you take it a whole of the Jehovah's Witnesses from Charles Taze Russell, he started teaching that his church is the true Christian church, and whoever's baptized in this church will go to heaven.
Once saved, always saved?
No, I don't know about that.
Well, I guess no, because they'll shun those who are backslidden, that's right.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's not once saved, always saved, because there are some churches that teach once saved, always saved, and the Bible, I don't think, teaches that either, you know. Otherwise,
I tend to believe you're right, but I haven't dived into that particular aspect of it. But, So all members of the Jehovah's Witnesses were part of the 144,000 if you get baptized in that religion. But back at the turn of the century, 1933 comes around.
Well, then wait a minute. They've had more than 144,000 Jehovah's Witnesses.
Right, right. Well, that was the teaching then. But in 1933, they're like the Babylonians and Nazis. They keep really good records of everything.
So in 1930, they're like the Mormons that have the genealogy and everything.
Yeah, the baptism thing that they do for the dead and all that. Well, in 1933, they found out that their ranks were swelling and they were going to pass the 144,000, and Armageddon hasn't come around yet. So they got a better understanding, and they had to change the rules quick because people are going to find out and say, hey, we're over, what's happening, you know? False prophecy. Well, that's when they came up with the separation, the two class system of the anointed, 144,000, and the other sheep, everyone else. And so they have unlimited, you know, they could absorb all these new members coming in into the church, which are 8 million now.
Well, they're that big. I didn't realize they were that big. I knew they were a lot. But I think they must have put a sign on my door because I haven't seen them in several years.
They'll blacklist your place if you hit them with Bible knowledge that counteracts their claim.
Oh, okay. They do blacklist you.
COVID, they didn't outlaw. They backed off. They backed off, yeah.
Well, I can't say I miss them.
Yep.
I got tired of the one-way discussions.
Oh yeah, that's how it is. Their attitude is, they're the teacher, you're the student. That's the whole, what do you call it?
They don't want to answer your questions.
No,
either.
They don't.
Because if they ask the wrong question, they...
Right off the bat, they're under the premonition that you got it wrong anyway, so why listen to you? You listen to me, I got the truth. That's the whole spiel of it all. You know, in their church services, they have one part, like half of it, like on a Wednesday night, they call it the midweek meeting, where...
Oh, yeah. Now that you mentioned, I do remember I had a boss who was doing, he didn't talk a lot about it at work, but once in a while he made a comment here and there.
Yep. Well, they're mandated to preach no matter what, even at work. So,
He was pretty soft-pedaling it, because I think he did that because he would have probably lost his job. Because the Harry Baptist is actually Greek Orthodox.
No. Oh, they have a hatred for the Catholic strain.
Yeah.
I think they're just jealous. But
I found a lot of people didn't like Harry Baptist, but I found him one of the fairest bosses I'd ever had.
Right. Everyone's different.
But, yeah. Yeah, it's interesting, dude. But yeah, I did have one. I just remember.
Yeah.
He was a deacon or whatever they call their preachers.
Elders.
Elder.
They don't have preachers. They're elders and ministerial servant, which is like their office clerk or whatever. But the elder in training in a way.
But all the elder is the one that gets up and reads the reading, right?
Yeah.
So
the members too, but the elders kind of supervise it all.
Okay, yeah, that's what he was.
But like half of their services is doing skits on how to sell their religion on in the door. So the women will get up there and they role play knocking on the door, and of course they call them the householders, the people that are preaching to. They're always accepting. I was like, oh yes, I would love a magazine, and I would love a Bible study next week every Tuesday. And I'll come to your church and everything, but, you know, in reality, they get the door slammed in their face. But, yeah, they role-play that.
So you've been to the services?
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Hey, see, I couldn't go just because I just don't like the fact that there's no windows. I've got to have...
Yeah.
I'm claustrophobic, and that would just drive me nuts.
When I didn't know any better, I went with my wife because I thought there were... You know, regular Christian denomination until I started
mainline listening. Christian.
Yeah, until I started listening to what they were saying, and I'm like, this is not right.
So were you raised in a church? But just didn't care?
I didn't care. I'm Pentecostal. My grandma was Pentecostal.
Oh, okay.
So, but it didn't take because, you know,
like
you
were Assembly of God or
I don't know. I didn't know the denominations then or now what she was. Fire and brimstone.
Yeah,
and you were saying that before in our conversation that, you know, you don't believe in scaring them into church.
Yeah.
Well, that's exactly what they did to me, and I rejected it all. Yeah.
Yeah, that's why a number of people do not. They just the emphasis of the love of God is there's two extremes. There's the burn over hanging somebody over the pit and, you know, roasting them like a weenie.
Yeah.
And then there's the God loves you so you can do anything.
Yep.
And unfortunately, there's a lot of people on one, and then when they find out there's another group that preaches different, then they reject God totally because, oh, he's not a loving God. No, he's a loving God because what is the effect of this? You're free to do anything. Well, yes, you're free to do anything if it's a godly,
yeah,
but it doesn't mean you can be a childless. Well, wait a minute, but God made me that way. No, you chose to be that way. And that's when they start rejecting God and say, well, God isn't a loving God because he doesn't accept me as I am. No, God, but you got to realize God has also got this child here is his child that you're molesting. So why is it okay for you to molest his child? It's not. So yes, there's a righteousness of God.
And what are the two most important commandments that he gives that kind of, you know, oversees everything is to love God with all your heart
and love others.
So that falls into, you know, if you hurt this child, you're not loving that child. You're ruining his life by selfish means or whatever.
Right.
So.